Hello, my name is Jamie Rhome, Storm Surge Specialist with the National Hurricane Center in Miami, Florida. Today we will be looking back at Hurricane Katrina, specifically at new storm surge forecasting products and services and how they've evolved over the years since Katrina. But before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge my co-authors, Kenneth Graham, Robbie Bird, and Cody Fritz, all of the National Hurricane Center. Hurricane Katrina was probably the most deadly, destructive, and consequential hurricane to strike the United States in modern history. And while the number of fatalities to this day remains still uncertain, the best case or the best understanding as of this recording were approximately 1,400 direct and indirect fatalities were attributed to the storm. Most of these deaths were directly caused by storm surge induced flooding and the aftermath that occurred in the New Orleans area as well as the Gulf Coast of Mississippi. And while we don't know exactly how many storm surge fatalities were included within this 1,400 estimate, the best guess as of this recording is 800 to 900. So if we look back at Katrina and the forecast information that was available at the time, publicly available at the time, the bulk of this information was contained within text messages in the form of our public advisory. Specifically, here's a snippet from that public advisory, which references storm surge flooding of 15 to 20 feet above normal tide levels, locally as high as 25 feet, along with large and dangerous battering waves. But note the reference here near and to the east of where the center makes landfall. This doesn't allow one to very easily determine their risk, as you would have to know where the storm was forecast to make landfall, the uncertainty therein, and then be able to mentally extrapolate near and to the east of where the center makes landfall. Also, what constitutes near? Is it 10 miles? Is it 100 miles? So you can see that while this forecast itself was incredibly accurate, as verifying data did show a 20 plus foot storm surge within the area of Mississippi, the communication lacked in terms of providing the explicit information for people to assess their risk. So back then, the storm surge forecast was also often inconsistent with the Saffir-Simpson scale. So if you recall back then, storm surge information or storm surge values were in the Saffir-Simpson scale with the wind-based information. And in this case, the storm surge information that was in the Saffir-Simpson scale was inconsistent with the forecast that was in the Katrina advisory. Note the reference above normal tide levels. So this would require the user to look up or know their normal tide levels and then add it to this 15 to 20 feet forecast on a consistent vertical datum or make a datum conversion transition, which is very difficult to do. It did not include geographical distinctions. There's no geographical references here for people to ground themselves. And again, it required the user to know where the center was forecast or projected to make landfall, along with the uncertainty in that forecast, and then mentally envision to the east of that location. And it was only provided 24 hours prior to the onset of winds. This information was typically included within the text forecast during the warning phase, which back then was 24 hours prior to the onset of winds. And that's basically it. Again, while the forecast itself was incredibly accurate, it probably lacked the necessary graphical depictions and geographical references to make it really local and resonate with residents. So in the years after Katrina, the National Weather Service really embarked on an aggressive campaign to overhaul the methods by which it forecasts and communicates storm surge. This included working with social scientists to determine what styles of products and associated designs are most effective to communicate storm surge risk to the general public, forecasters, emergency managers, and the media. And the media was really an important one because they're one of our primary partners in conveying forecast information. So understanding their graphical needs and making a graphic which could be conveyed on air was really, really important. All this led to the implementation of several changes, which I'll detail in the next slide. But the bulk of these changes were focused on operational high-resolution inundation graphics, as well as an first ever in this country explicit storm surge watch warning system. So if we go back and look at the timeline of changes, major changes since 2005, it really began with the creation of a probabilistic storm surge guidance suite called PSURGE. The P surge is just a probabilistic wrapper around the storm surge model, slosh. So basically what it does is it takes the official forecast and then builds alternate forecast scenarios using the error distributions. And then this way it can properly account for or include the forecast uncertainty. The removal of the storm surge from the Saffir-Simpson scale really came after Hurricane Ike in 2009. We began referencing above ground level in our text products in 2009. Remember that example I showed earlier was above normal tide levels. We switched this to above ground level reference in 2009. Tide was added to P-surge to produce more of a total water level guided sweep. And then one of the bigger ones is in 2015, we began producing high resolution inundation mapping, which visually showed the potential water rise above ground, as far as well as how far inland the water could go. The biggest of them all was a storm surge watch and warning in 2017. And this is an IPAWS WEA message, which means it will trigger your cell phone to go off, similar to an Amber Alert, if you're under a storm surge warning. So this is very important because it ensures maximum throughput in terms of communication directly to the public. We also upgraded our MOMS and MEOWS, which are risk products to use for mitigation ahead of the storm, as well as preparation during a storm. So we're making those higher resolution enable better use of them at the local emergency management level. We began extending the lead times for the explicit peak values in the public advisory from 24 hours to 48 hours. And then finally in 2020, even though during the pandemic, we launched a new experimental peak storm surge forecast graphic, which is basically a visual representation of these peak values in the public text only advisories. So let's look at how those products might have looked back in Katrina, or how the forecast might look now if there were storms similar to Katrina to impact Southeast Louisiana. Starting first with the probabilistic storm surge guidance. Remember, this is an ensemble, and you can see here in the bottom right-hand side the tracks which would comprise that ensemble. You can see the tracks fan out a spread analogous to the cone to include the uncertainty associated with track variance, but it also includes variations of intensity, forward speed, and size of which is very important, can be very important for determining storm surge. The potential storm surge flooding map would look something like this, where the areas in red depict the potential for 9 feet or greater storm surge. And you can see how just a powerful way to visually depict the geographical areas most at risk. Not only the overall coastline, but how far inland the water could go. And this latter part is especially important for complicated coastlines such as Louisiana, where communicating risk inland, such as north shore of Lake Pontchartrain or in and around Lake Maurepas, can be especially difficult with text-only product. The storm surge watch warning would look something like this. Remember, the warning would come 36 hours prior to onset of conditions. Watch would be 48. And you can see how we would go ahead in an example like this with a storm of this magnitude, overtop the levees or depict the potential of overtopping, such that the WEA messages themselves would be distributed directly to the residents in the metropolitan New Orleans area. The peak storm surge forecast graphic, this is a new experimental product that began this past hurricane season in 2020. You can see how it would geographically show the areas most at risk. So this is a much more powerful way to depict, instead of near and to the east of where the center makes landfall, now you can show on a map where those areas would be. And this lends itself to better communication over more modern distribution systems such as social media. So if we compare where we were back then in 2005, we've really come a long way. So look, here was the original forecast. And while the numbers on this graphic and this old text message from Katrina are largely the same, you can see how the graphic itself really lends itself to clearer communication, especially on the geographic reach of that area. But more importantly, with a storm surge warning and the ability to directly disseminate warning messages to the public via WEA, we really think we could communicate better the risk in a storm like Katrina should it happen again. But is it working? So since 2017, there have been 14 U.S. landfalling hurricanes, or 21 total tropical cyclones requiring a storm surge watch or warning. Here are the listings of them by year. Of those, five were major hurricanes on the Saffir-Simpson scale: Harvey, Irma, Maria, Michael, and Laura. And during this time, there have been only seven storm surge fatalities. So by context, Katrina is thought to have produced somewhere between 800 and 900 storm surge related fatalities. And more recently, Sandy, 41 due to storm surge. And since the launch of these new products and services in 2017, despite 21 landfalling tropical cyclones, there have been only seven storm surge fatalities. So we really think we're starting to make a dent in fatalities owing to arising from storm surge. And while this is not a mission accomplished moment, storm surge still constitutes the greatest potential threat to life during a landfalling tropical cyclone. We feel we're starting to bring down fatalities arising from storm surge. So this concludes my presentation on Katrina. Thank you so much for your time today.